One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. There's hardly a human being alive who couldn't quote you Neil Armstrong's iconic words as he pressed the first boot print anyone has ever put into the surface of the moon. This singular moment was a huge victory for the United States at a time when America was locked in a fierce snarling match with the Soviet Union. For 45 years, the world was a tense, simmering pot of distrust, ready to boil over into full-scale war at any moment. It was us against them, capitalism versus communism. Russia and the US squared off in a competition to prove that their way was better than the other. Considering the international stakes invested in the space race, it might be tempting to call conspiracy theorists nothing more than jealous nutjobs. NASA has certainly done everything they can to disprove naysayers, but the more you examine the evidence, the less certain it seems that what we saw was real. So is it true? Did America really land the first man on the moon, or did NASA pull off the biggest hoax in human history? In this video, I'll explain to you why I think the moon landing images are fake, but not necessarily in the way you think. Stay tuned to the end of the video to see what I mean. But before we begin, if you're enjoying the video, then always feel free to leave a like and press your own print down on that subscribe button. You can ring the notification bell for a chance to be the first one to view new content from my channel. Now let's get this party started. On the surface, the Apollo 11 mission was just a natural consequence of the Cold War between America and the Soviet Union. It was a crucial play for the US, a vital goal scored close to the start of the game. As far as the US was concerned, this victory gave America hope, crushed the Russian spirit, and set the entirety of humanity up a path towards technological advancement. There's just one problem. The original moon landing broadcast was fake. At least, that's what 28% of Russians, 25% of Britons, and 20% of Americans think. And they have good reason to. The more layers you peel back, the darker and less certain details surrounding the Apollo 11 mission become. Or at least those involving the footage, anyway. Let's start with radiation. Our atmosphere acts like the panels on a greenhouse, filtering light and protecting us against dust and debris the way those plastic sheets keep your plants from drowning in the rain. But outside our atmosphere, space is full of radiation. At any given moment, ships and astronauts actively in space are exposed to 50 to 2,000 millisieverts, or MSV, of radiation. To put that into perspective, one MSV is like getting three chest x-rays all at the same time. So out in space, everything is under the constant onslaught of the equivalent of 150 to 6,000 trips to the radiologist rolled into one. Rockets and the suits astronauts wear during spacewalks are shielded against a variety of elements from the intense cold to, you guessed it, radiation. The camera that took video of Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin and Michael Collins was just your everyday film and reel camera used by television programs at the time. An RCA to be exact. It wasn't some special high-tech camcorder with reflective sighting or heat shields. It was the same piece of equipment that brought audiences Gunsmoke and I Love Lucy, which was definitely cool for the RCA company, but radiation has a way of affecting film. Sometimes it adds more static to the image. It can deaden the contrast or even add bright, speckled light and patches to video and photos. Essentially, it ages the reel in a similar way to leaving it out on a shelf for months would. Just look at images taken of the Chernobyl disaster and you can see the gritty texture and bars of light burned into the bottoms of many photographs. Even after supposedly passing through the radiation belt that surrounds our planet, the 35 reels of film they brought back remained crisp and untouched. Now I know what you're thinking. The radiation at Chernobyl was greater than levels on the moon or even leaving and re-entering the Earth's atmosphere. Even with suits, rescue and excavation teams could only stand to be in Chernobyl for a few minutes at a time. Any degradation on the moon footage would have been less, sure, but there still should have been some kind of evidence of radiation exposure on unshielded recordings taken in space. If the quality of the film hasn't convinced you, then let's talk about their contents. Never in a million years would people back in the 1960s have even dreamed we'd have things at home, like computers or cell phones. If you went back in time and showed someone a cute cat video off YouTube, they'd have looked at you like some kind of sorcerer. Back in the day, TV was played once, shoved in a protective tube, and stored away. VHS and recording your favorite shows at home wasn't even invented until the mid-1970s, so the folks at NASA probably never expected anyone to be able to go back and analyze the moon landing broadcast. If you go back and watch the entire CBS broadcast, which you can do on YouTube, and I'll leave a link below, you might start to notice something a little odd when the astronauts fall. Granted, gravity on the moon is supposed to be only a sixth of what it is on Earth. If you could step off of your front porch and land on the moon, not only would you have superpowers, you'd weigh about as much as a small child. I'm pretty sure you'd still fall the same way though. Maybe a little slower, but still the regular stumble, push yourself up kind of deal. Especially considering the heavy packs and awkward suits the three astronauts were wearing. In the video, when they fall, their heads tip forward and they flail in midair like there's a wire holding them just about at the waist. And when they get back up, it's almost like they're being pulled from behind rather than pushing themselves up with their own bodies. There's even this hilarious compilation video of astronauts falling that I'll link to as well, because it does as a good job proving my point as it does making people laugh. They just don't look like they're actually falling. They look like they're bent over a swing on their bellies. Everybody says at that time it would have been harder to fake the footage than to actually go to the moon, but that's ridiculous. First of all, the training grounds NASA used to prepare astronauts for space look an awful lot like space in that video. It's entirely possible they built another set, gave it a black background, and filmed the astronaut bouncing around on pulleys. And secondly, we know they had the ability to fake images. There's a photo of Michael Collins walking on the moon that's literally just an edited version of a so-called photo test. The colors were reversed, the background was blacked out, but if you line the two images up, it's easy to see they're the same thing. The angles are the same. The pose is identical. Admittedly, photos are far easier to tamper with than video, but it's impossible for us to go back and check the raw footage for editing because no one seems to have any clue as to where it is. More than that, the original telemetry data from the mission was written over due to a shortage in magnetic tape, so the reels are missing and the data is gone. There's no solid proof left that the landing footage wasn't fake. Does that mean we absolutely didn't go to the moon? Not necessarily. It's entirely possible that someone, whether that was Armstrong or not, became the first man to set foot on the moon as a result of the space race. America still could have won. The film just didn't survive the journey back or was too grainy to make anything out, so they made a new video. That's quite possible, and it's hard to deny that Neil's one small step line is awfully cool-headed for a guy about to make such a monumental achievement that would literally change mankind forever. Of course, if you don't count a mastery of the English language as evidence that the moon landing footage was staged, then maybe you need something a little more solid to change your opinion. Something like a fake moon rock, perhaps? In 1969, the former Prime Minister of Holland, Willem Dries Jr., received a generous personal gift from the American ambassador of the time. This international offering was given shortly after a visit from Neil Armstrong and his crew. We'll never know whether or not Dries was excited to receive this so-called piece of the moon, but the plaque it was set on was actually signed by the three astronauts of the Apollo 11 mission. So it had to be real, right? When he died in 1988, the moon rock from America was donated to the Rijksmuseum, where its authenticity was confirmed via a phone call to NASA. It wasn't until 2009 that someone actually tested its competition. As it turned out, the moon rock was, embarrassingly enough, nothing more than petrified wood. It was a fake. Did NASA send the fake on purpose, or did they just agree over the phone to save face for America? Either way, the whole situation is a big old lump sketchy. In fact, there's a whole bunch of other less than reputable happenings surrounding the landing. Chief among those is NASA's use of known Nazi scientists in order to further their program. Werner Magnus Maximilian Freiherr von Braun wasn't just a guy with a really long name. He was also an accomplished aerospace engineer, a father of three, and a Nazi. There are those who escaped concentration camps who can point to von Braun and name him as one of those monsters who lived in the lap of luxury while people were being slaughtered by the thousands. He also happens to be the driving mind behind the success of the American space program. Apollo director Sam Phillips has been quoted saying that without Braun, America never would have reached the moon so quickly, or perhaps not even at all. America pretty much went from fighting a war against Nazis to inviting them in the back door in order to show up Russia. Even if you ignore the hypocritical nature of America's government using of old war criminals when it suited them, it's still a little odd that the Apollo missions were the one and only time mankind has ever gone to the moon with more than just a machine. We make show after show in movies galore based on the concept of space exploration, and yet no one has been more than 400 miles away from Earth since 1972. You'd think by now we'd be waking up in our condo on Mars. But maybe we just like Earth. Maybe we haven't needed to go all that far. Or maybe we never did at all. If you enjoyed this video, then why not subscribe? Hit that bell icon as well so you're more likely to get notified of our noble answers to your burning questions. Also, if you have any questions you want answered, make sure to tell me in the comments section down below. And to keep filling your brain with regal knowledge, check out these videos here. They're magnificent.